My name is James Robson, and I'm the Victor and William Fung Director of the Harvard Asia Center. I'd like to welcome you to the Asia Center's Research Talk Series, which is part of a new series of virtual programming at the Asia Center. The research talks are aimed at showcasing some of the fascinating research that's being done on various facets of Asia by Harvard students, graduate students, faculty, Asia Center affiliates, and other specialists. We very much hope you enjoyed learning from these talks.
Hello, I'm Stefan Huebner. I'm a Senior Research Fellow at the Asia Research Institute of the National University of Singapore and also an affiliate of the Harvard University Asia Center, where I previously was a SSRC, Transregional Research, and a Fulbright Fellow. In this presentation, I will talk about one of the topics that I'm addressing in my current book project, which is a history of the industrialization and urbanization of the ocean since the early 20th century. The 20th century shaped the global, very terrestrial mindset that focused on controlling or removing water, for example, through large dams and irrigation projects. However, if we leave this increasingly terrestrialized mindset and approach things from an oceanic perspective, we see that at the same time, an adaptation process began to take place, which through industrialization and urbanization created a rising number of amphibious human habitats above the ocean's surface, including, for example, offshore oil and gas drilling platforms or, more recently, high-tech floating or elevated houses. The topic that I want to talk about here is how offshore oil and gas platforms historically turned into very important vectors or pathways for the translocation of alien and potentially invasive marine species. After all, such platforms didn't create habitats only for humans, but below the surface also for marine species. Two offshore oil hubs that I'm interested in are Japan and Singapore, which did not become major offshore oil producers, but whose shipyards built a large number of platforms for export and provided maintenance services for them, meaning that platforms as vectors often passed through their waters. In terms of vectors and species translocations, think for example of an equivalent to the so-called Columbian Exchange. There, too, a new vector, meaning ships able to cross the Atlantic and slightly later the Pacific Ocean, since the late 15th century began to intentionally, but in other cases also unintentionally, translocate species between the Old World and the New World. I think when we talk about offshore drilling, one of the things that come to the mind of people are disasters like oil spills. So here I want to shift attention from very intense disasters with drastic visual impacts, like such oil spills, that are nevertheless quite limited in their spatial and temporal dimension, to biological invasions. Such biological invasions in their temporal dimension normally develop slowly, but can have an impact that lasts for millennia, and spatially, they can develop a very broad reach. As a consequence, they normally don't catch the media attention that oil spills and so on receive. Such translocations of alien species were and are very significant threats to biodiversity, as international organizations and expert groups like, for example, the International Union for Conservation of Nature, the International Maritime Organization, the Intergovernmental Panel on Climate Change, and the IPBES, that's the Intergovernmental Science Policy Platform on Biodiversity and Ecosystem Services, further emphasized in major studies that were released during the last years. The point is that oil and gas platforms can provide conditions that strongly increase the likelihood that members of marine species survive a transoceanic journey to a different region that lies outside their naturally occurring range. If conditions in this new bioregion allow their survival, they potentially establish themselves. Here we talk, for example, about conditions like water temperature and salinity, or about the presence or absence of local predators or competitors for food and habitat space. If the members of the alien species manage to establish themselves and then cause harm to local biodiversity or the shape and conditions of habitats, or have a negative impact on human health, since, for example, they carry diseases, or damage human-built structures, then stakeholders talk about a biological invasion or bio-invasion. I should briefly mention that bioinvasion should be understood as taking place within the broader framework of a preceding human bioinvasion, so to speak, of marine ecosystems that then provided some of the conditions for the species translocation and its bioinvasion. So why are offshore oil and gas platforms such an important element in the history of marine bioinvasions since the 1960s? Well, like other vessels, platforms experience biofouling, meaning the gradual accumulation of marine organisms on their surfaces. Just to give you an example that also connects to the present COVID-19 situation. Because of a lack of passengers, an economic downturn, a decreased demand for oil and international cargo transfers, and so on, cruise ships, oil tankers, cargo ships, and oil platforms potentially become idle. They remained stationary in the water, meaning that parts of their hulls were submerged. What happens is the development of underwater ecosystems on their hulls. Over time, marine bacteria and fungi, algae, barnacles, sponges, tube worms, mussels, corals, oysters, and other species can settle and form mature fouling communities that also sustain, for example, crabs, starfishes, and fish. The longer the vessels remain stationary, the better the conditions for the development of such biofouling communities that potentially become very complex and self-sustaining. When such vessels, without fouling removal, travel again, they take these submerged ecosystems with them to new places, where maybe certain members of the biofouling community do not naturally occur. In contrast to long stationary periods, rapid movement across the ocean has a negative damaging impact on the biofouling communities and inhabitants, or prevents their growth. Still, maybe the pandemic will have some yet unknown consequences in terms of species translocations, especially considering what is happening in Asia in terms of idle ships. So, once again, why are offshore oil and gas platforms such an important element in the history of marine bioinvasions since about in the 1950s? Well, in contrast to merchant vessels, platforms move very slowly. Often they are towed at a speed of a few kilometers per hour, which is very different from merchant vessels that were designed to rapidly move cargo between ports, often traveling more than 20 or 30 kilometers per hour, depending on the ship type. So, COVID-19 aside, merchant vessels usually also don't stay idle, whereas platforms often remain stationary for very long periods of time, often years, or become permanently fixed to the seafloor. Platforms therefore constitute artificial reefs and can carry whole ecosystems with them during a relocation. They move these potentially self-sustaining fouling communities at low speed, meaning that they provide less deadly habitat conditions and food situations than ships and other vessels. So my point is, what we saw since about the 1950s is the emergence and growth of what I call a global platform archipelago of hard surfaces, made from steel or concrete, which provided reef-like habitats for marine species. This archipelago, platform archipelago, rapidly created a new maritime geography that was not part of conventional sea lanes linking ports to each other, but developed parallel to them. The global platform archipelago, spatially connected through its platforms as drilling tools and as vectors, shipyards, meaning sites of construction and maintenance, exploration areas, and offshore oil and gas fields to each other. The emergence and growth of this platform archipelago of hard surfaces then also allowed interaction with similar hard surface habitats that were increasingly built along industrialized and urbanized coastlines, including ports, such as in Japan. So when we talk about Japanese and Singaporean waters from the 1970s, shipyards in both offshore oil hubs constructed large numbers of mobile and fixed platforms. For example, among the 194 mobile platforms under construction or ordered in 1981, Japanese and Singaporean companies were tasked with building 38 and 28 respectively. Finding historical sources on submerged platform ecosystems is a bit tricky, but the case of a steel jacket illustrates how members of marine species used the platform archipelago's hard surfaces as habitats that reduced their vulnerability during translocations to new environments. between September and November 1975, the jacket of a fixed platform called Maui A was towed from the Japanese shipyard in Ise Bay that had built it to New Zealand. There, the at least 130 meter tall jacket was fixed to the seafloor and hosted the production and living quarter modules at the Maui gas field. During the journey, it moved on one of its sides. So flotation chambers in two of its legs made it self-floating. This journey lasted 68 days, covering a distance of more than 8,000 kilometers with a low speed between 3 to 9 kilometers per hour. Interestingly, nobody had bothered to apply anti-fouling paint before the journey, probably because it lost its effectiveness after 1 to 2 years. This duration was, after all, marginal compared to a fixed platform's lifespan of 2 to 3 decades. The ecosystem, which began to develop while the steel jacket was briefly in Japanese waters, gives some insights on how the ecosystems of other platforms operating in or leaving Japanese waters potentially looked like. Although many individuals were not in good shape, the platform habitat enabled barnacles, crabs and fish that originated in Japanese and Central Indo-Pacific waters to survive this southward journey. By the way, I should mention that this did not mean that they would survive winter or predators after arrival. Unsurprisingly, since the jacket was newly built, exposure to larvae of fouling organisms in Japanese waters and during the journey had been limited. Still, the jacket arrived with 6 alien barnacle species not encountered before in New Zealand. One of them were bay barnacles, which already were invasive in the Northern Hemisphere. The bay barnacles can serve to illustrate the multidirectional spread of species through the growing global platform archipelago. Bay barnacles originated in the Atlantic coast of North or South America, but they were already classified as naturalized in the waters of several European countries. They were first recorded in 1952 in Japan's Ago Bay, a center of pearl oyster aquaculture, and in 1959 spotted in nearby Ise Bay, where the jacket had been built. During the course of the 1960s, they also appeared in the Seto Inland Sea, the East China Sea, and the Sea of Japan. Without question, shipping was a vector, but during this decade, platforms were also exploring for oil around Japan. Some of the problems for coastal and marine stakeholders in Japan included the bay barnacles settling in and clogging water intake tunnels and pipes of a growing number of seaside power plants, chemical and heavy industry facilities, or firefighting systems that were an outcome of Japan's high growth economy. The barnacles also caused economic damage to aquaculture, and in the case of ships and platform hulls, they increased the friction resistance during travel, meaning that more fuel had to be spent to move the vessel and more greenhouse gases were released. As their presence on Maui A, the steel jacket, showed, Japanese platforms potentially exported them to further regions. Interaction between the platform archipelago of hard surfaces and shallow water coral reefs also seems to have been a very important vector for the spread of invasive alien sun corals along 3,000 kilometers of Brazil's coastline. From the late 1980s onward, these sun corals began to be spotted on platforms operating off Brazil's new offshore oil frontier. The sun corals' naturally occurring range was the Indo-Pacific, which shifts attention back to Japan and Singapore as major offshore oil hubs. As a result of the Brazilian government's growing interest in offshore oil fields, its national oil company became a customer of Singaporean and Japanese shipyards. A journey through the Indian Ocean, where sun corals could potentially settle, and the South Atlantic meant 8,800 to 9,000 kilometers in the case of Singapore and about 11,500 kilometers for Japan. It should be noted that sun corals had already established themselves in the Caribbean during the 1940s and since the 1960s slowly spread across the US Gulf of Mexico, assisted by platforms on which they were found. Platforms from the US Gulf or the Caribbean thus might have been additional vectors for the sun corals' early translocation to and spread within Brazilian waters. Sun corals recently also established themselves in the Canary Islands. The Canaries in 2011 had turned into yet another offshore oil hub, and the port facilities where platforms were maintained were the places where the sun corals first settled. Moreover, in 2012, 10 out of 10 platforms that were examined and which were located off Gabon in the Gulf of Guinea, another offshore oil resource frontier, also hosted sun corals. All these presences potentially interacted with the bioinvasion in Brazilian waters and again emphasized the rising number of platform journeys between a growing number of source and recipient bioregions within the global platform archipelago. So what's the problem? After they spread to Brazilian coral reefs, the sun corals began to kill local corals and to change coral reef ecosystems. They were able to outcompete several local coral species up to the level of future extinction. It seems that the continuing spread of the sun corals may have an increasingly negative impact on fish populations that use reefs as feeding grounds, which then also means that reef fisheries would suffer from their spread. I initially mentioned that numerous international organizations see bioinvasions as a major threat to biodiversity. So the International Maritime Organization is currently working on the topic of biofouling. In any case, I expect that the topic will further grow in importance. Think about the rising number of recently built floating or fixed wind turbines, or the floating houses and floating solar panels, and so on. Even if they remain stationary, their hard surfaces will provide new artificial reef conditions. Consequently, they can serve as stepping stones for marine bioinvasions by members of species that were translocated through mobile platforms, ships, and other vectors. So this overview was an example for leaving the initially mentioned terrestrial mindset and to approach Asia's global history from an oceanic perspective, here with a focus on the long-distance impacts of industrial development in the age of oil. Part of my research will go into my current book project, as mentioned. However, I also want to briefly mention another project that I'm working on together with Ian J. Miller and William Tsutsui from Harvard and Nadine He from Free University Berlin. Our edited volume on Oceanic Japan is based on three conferences hosted in Singapore, Berlin, and at Harvard, and brings together an amazing group of more than 20 contributors who are interested in approaching Japanese and global history from an oceanic perspective. The edited volume will come out with University of Hawaii Press probably in 2021-22. Thanks a lot, and goodbye.